this is.
Fun with iPads is what it is.
is that what these are? We
yeah,
got
this
iPads
is going this
here?
Is something I made, and it's. It's using four iPads that are broken up into buttons, which speak to the computer. And what it allows me to do is actually take the sounds from his record and exactly as they are without changing them or putting my own spin on them. And I can reproduce any sound on the record of any length of at any time. So I could put, anything. I could put banjos. I could put just whatever. So
we're all out of work, by the way.
The beginning of the end of country music right here. But it was my goal to compliment just what he does, and sure. He's such a brave artist the way he records. I mean, no one else would let me do this, so this is and I felt like I wanted to bring some of that to the stage in
sure.
the live
well,
show.
Well, I mean, that's actually a very cool point that there are, I'm sure, plenty of artists who would look at this and go, oh no, not in my world. That's not happening.
You know what's been really good about this record is that it feels very much like it's been on its own sort of energy flow. Every part of it has been it's been going in a direction, and I've just sort of gone with it.
Right.
And even so much as Nate coming into my life is last year when I was working on the record and I started to work with various people, Jeff and various other people, and there was a lot of computerization and roboticism and drum machines and machinery happening, which I've always been fascinated with the integration of the two. And it's really come from writing with drum machines and playing banjo. There's always been this dance between the machine and the instrument, the organic, and I've always loved those two things and how they can work together. I mean, Uptown Baby was such a sort of seminal moment for
right.
me
sure.
as a musician,
yeah. uh-huh.
watching how that record came together and seeing that could work really well and fascinatingly. That Acton Baby really was I kept referencing that when I was making Fuse. I would go back to it and listen to how they did things and how they did that and how this sort of goes together. And so I've stayed fascinated by that integration. And I said to my band, I said, we need another guy in the band for this next tour. I can feel it coming. And they said, well, what does he play? And I said, I can't define it yet. He's not a keyboard player. He's not a DJ. He's not a percussionist. He does all of those things, but somehow I don't want to see turntables.
He's a magician.
I don't want to see a keyboard. I need something else, and so I could see it.
Yeah.
And my bass player Jerry's like, man, you should get Nate. I mean, he that might be his thing. And after we met, I think it was shortly thereafter, you came up with this contraption.
Yeah.
And created it. So
does
it's crazy.
Does it happen? Yeah. Just
the phantom.
The phantom. Coming to retail stores near you very soon. That is a ridiculously awesome thing. But let's move on. So there are some collaborations on this record, and there is a notable one called The Fighter.
Yes.
And there is a yeah.
I love the way everyone here knows these songs better than I do.
And there is a notable vocalist who is on this.
Yeah, Carrie Underwood is
right.
singing on this song.
Right.
Right.
So why Carrie?
Wise guys.
I mean, what did you hear in this song that you put together with her voice?
I was working on a song with Busby, who's an incredible songwriter, and actually he came in and helped us finish out a song that I was doing with Niall,
yeah.
Rogers, called Sun Don't Let Me Down, which we'll get to in a second. But I really loved working with Busby, and I said, I was in London, and I said, can you come over and we can keep working? I got to keep working. So he flew to London, we found a studio, and I was in an Uber, going to the studio in the morning,
nice.
And I had this idea that I wanted to write a duet song, not the traditional singing together, but I wanted, this really came from a very simple thing that sort of happened early on in my relationship
mm-hmm.
with Nick, was just this sort of, this need for reassurance that this is a good, safe place for me, you know, and am I gonna be there, you know, when I need to be there,
yeah.
And it's a very simple idea, and so in my head I thought, well, it's probably as simple as you know, the girl sang "What If I Fall," and the guy's like, "Well, I won't let you fall." And "What If I Cry?" And says, "I'll never make you cry." And you know, and if I get scared, and my experience has been, when that happens, you just hold her tighter. And when the world's trying to get to her, I'll be the fighter. And so I just went, okay, let's just go with this. And it was incredibly simple. But I got to the studio and said to Busby, I got this idea from Melody, and here's the chords. And he just fleshed out a track quite quickly, and he sang the girl's part.
which I believe we have a little snippet on. This is entertaining.
This is our little London demo, which didn't change much at all once we got into the record.
So I'm looking at Keith Urban's laptop here, and I'm just checking out your what you have up here just in your playlist. So I see Peter Gabriel, I see Janis Joplin, I see the Jack Attack. That looks that looks fascinating.
That's for the kids.
That's what I thought.
You got Leonard Cohen documentary that's really good.
Anyway, I digress.
It's all music stuff.
Right. But I understand as you were kind of putting this song together, you were thinking about Meatloaf.
Well, I remember the song "Paradise" by Dashboard Light, and I always loved that.
Great song. It's crazy.
But I always loved the guy and girl talking to each other in that song. I just thought that was really unusual. And same with "Baby It's Cold Outside." You know, the idea of just the conversation.
Sure.
And this is obviously super short, but nonetheless, it felt born of a true thing happening in our relationship early on, and so. Busby and I said, like, obviously Busby can't be the girl. And
Clearly not.
We got to find somebody. And so we both said, you know, Carrie would be great. And I even went so far as to start going through a lot of her songs, listening to where her vocal sits, where the timbre in her voice fits right, and all that stuff. And I'm like, she is perfect for this. So sent her the song, and thankfully she loved it.
Well, and this is, you know, this is where the miracles of sort of the modern technology in recording, because she ultimately put her vocal down. She was in a studio somewhere in the Midwest.
Yeah.
And you were making a video someplace else.
I was. We did have a deadline by now for the record.
Conveniently.
The third single. It's like, you can't keep putting out singles. You gotta put a record out. So the record was basically done except for Carrie singing on the fighter. Everything else was done, and the record was ready to be mastered, just needed her to sing. She was on tour, and she said, I got one day off, which is before your record's finished, needs to be finished, and it's in St. Louis, Missouri. I've got one day off. I can go into a studio on my one day off. God bless you, Carrie, that's the work ethic. And so I said, well, I'm shooting a video that day for wasted time, like on the other side of the country. I can't get out of it, you know, I can't send somebody to fill in for me. But I said to Busby, can you fly to St. Louis and find a studio? And he did.
And not sing,
that's right. And he's a great producer, so he just got in there with Carrie, and I took a break from filming the video, and I would FaceTime them. I'm like, this is so 2016 right now, you know? FaceTime in the studio, playing me the track.
Yeah. So let's hear a little bit of this, however you care to construct it.
You can play a little bit of her voice, I think, right? So Carrie.
What if I fall?
So there's another collaboration on this record that I don't think that if we